Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3, verses 13 to 17. And you can find this passage on page 682 of your pew Bibles, or you can follow along on the screen. So let's listen to God's Word together. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me?" Jesus replied, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." God, we thank you for the gospel. We thank you for the story of your Son Jesus, for what it, the ways it speaks to us. So God, we pray that this morning as we reflect on this story, this particular story, that you would give us eyes to see you and ears to hear you. You would also give us hearts and minds that are open to what you might be saying and doing in our lives. It's in your Son's name we pray these things. There are a lot of great things about being a minister. And one of the blessings of ministry is a chance to be a part of some of the most memorable moments in people's lives. So to stand with a couple on their wedding day, or to gather with a family as they say goodbye to a loved one, to get the chance to speak words of scripture and to offer up prayers during these times, I would never presume to be worthy of these moments. But they never really get old. And as many pastors would likely attest, these moments are special not just because of the ceremonies themselves. They're special because of the way that they connect to something bigger. The way that they allow us to look beyond the moment and see how that moment fits into a larger view of God's Word. So every wedding ceremony is nice in its own way, but when that ceremony paints a picture of a couple's covenantal commitment to God, to one another, and to the larger Christian community, it's something truly beautiful. Every funeral is moving. But when a funeral tells a story of a life lived in faithfulness, a life used by God to impact others, well, then a funeral can become an occasion for celebration and even worship as we give thanks to God for the time that we spent with our departed brother and sister. And as we anticipate together and look forward together in hope of the resurrection. But of all these ceremonies, of all these powerful and holy moments that we ministers and we members of the Christian community get to share in, perhaps none is as significant or as important as a baptism. To stand in a baptistry with a person who is just beginning his or her first steps in the life of faith, to get to speak words of encouragement and exhortation, to get to pray as a community for the continued growth, for the sustained faithfulness of the person who is being baptized. This is such a heavy and joyful and emotionally charged event that words don't really do it justice. We don't in any way feel deserving of these events, but we embrace them because they mean so much. And so we come to these moments and we walk away from them convinced that God has been at work in some mysterious way to bring new life. And also convinced that we've been blessed to get to participate in the fulfillment of God's promises. With the knowledge that what has just happened in the moment of baptism is something that connects us to something bigger than ourselves. It connects us to a story of salvation that God has been telling for generations. Well, the story that we read today from the third chapter of Matthew's Gospel gives us an account of a truly significant event, the baptism of Jesus. Yet, for all its power, this story has also inspired its fair share of conversation and debate and maybe even puzzlement. Readers have long wondered what exactly it means that Jesus would make the journey at the age of 30 from Nazareth in Galilee to this wilderness region of Judea where his cousin John is preaching and prophesying. in order to receive John's baptism. Generations of Christians have kind of scratched their heads at what exactly is going on in this passage. And to be fair, it seems that we're kind of in good company in our confusion. In a characteristic display of humility, John himself seems to be resistant. John himself seems to be even a little bit perplexed as to why Jesus would want to submit to this rite. A few verses earlier in Matthew's gospel, John had declared himself unworthy even to untie Jesus' sandals. In the fourth gospel, John will say of Jesus, "He must become greater, and I must become less." Well, here, when Jesus comes to be baptized, John asks a very understandable question. Why do you come to me? I need to be baptized by you. Why are you doing this? Well, our own questions about Jesus' baptism often come from another place. Ever since Matthew recorded this event, and ever since we Christians have been reading about it, readers have gotten a little bit hung up on what Jesus is accomplishing here. What is this event achieving in terms of results? Why is Jesus' baptism necessary? Why is it even logical? These questions have been around for a long time, but they kind of take on a new tone, I think, in a culture like ours. See, our culture, like some cultures before us, is dominated by a kind of individualistic approach to religion. The idea of, well, what's in it for us? A lot of people look at faith that way. And when we look at religion in this way, we're tempted to consider baptism, like a lot of spiritual practices, like a lot of exercises, as a sort of formula, as a method designed to attain favor or produce some good in our lives. As I said, much of modern religion, including modern Christianity, approaches the life of faith in this way. In the past generation or so, there have been two major, what we might call, cultural heresies, or false Christianities, that have taken root. One of these you may have heard of is the prosperity gospel. This is the brand of Christianity that we so often encounter on televised broadcasts and in best-selling books. These teachers and preachers who take the power of positive thinking and they douse it in religious language. This version of Christianity offers material blessings as a result of faithfulness. This version of Christianity tells us that God's will is for us to succeed in every endeavor. And if we will just claim our victory, then we can have it. Well, another version of Christianity that's maybe a little bit less familiar, but is certainly just as pervasive in our culture, has been called moralistic therapeutic theism. It's a fancy name for a version of Christianity that isn't so much about material blessings, but rather emotional ones. In this brand of faith, people will tell us, God wants us to feel good. God's greatest desire for us is to be happy and to be well-adjusted. To not worry so much about things like sin, and instead to pursue our bliss. In both of these Christianities, the idea is, what can we get out of this? What is in it for us? And in both of these tellings, religious practices and pursuits are about offering us goodies that make life better. And so even something like baptism has the potential to get caught up in this, to become just another transaction. Baptism can come to be seen as a thing that we do in order to get something for ourselves. And in this context, Jesus' baptism actually does make very little sense. Surely the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world doesn't need this sacrament. He doesn't need baptism in order to attain salvation. He who is fully obedient to the will of the Father doesn't come to the water of baptism harboring any sins that need to be cleansed. The only begotten, beloved Son doesn't need baptism to make him feel better about his status before God. And so we might scratch our heads and wonder at this strange action. For many, the recourse has been to simply make Jesus' baptism a kind of object lesson, as if this were nothing more than a teachable moment. Jesus gets baptized just to show us that we need to get baptized. And I'm sure there is some truth to this. I'm sure there's some truth to the fact that what Jesus was doing here was setting an example of what obedience and, faithfulness looks like. But unless we go beyond that, then this explanation of what transpired on that day in which Gideon was is kind of unsatisfying. It leads us to the conclusion that Jesus' baptism is kind of a pantomime of faithfulness. It's just a demonstration of what he wants us to do rather than an event of any real significance for him or any real significance for his ministry. But if we read Matthew's account, we see that this is actually an event of great significance for Jesus. The way Matthew describes the heavens being opened with the dove descending and the voice of God speaking. The fact that this event occurs right before Jesus' time of trial in the desert, which we'll talk about next week, where he goes into the wilderness to be tempted. This is clearly an important moment for Christ. This is clearly a pivotal point in his life of faithfulness to his Father. When Jesus tells John, it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness, he's ascribing great importance to this baptism that he's urging John to do. So maybe then Jesus' baptism isn't just about a kind of transaction. Maybe it's not a formula. Maybe it's not an event isolated unto itself. Maybe Jesus' baptism is a crucial element of the story that God is telling, the story that God had been telling about the Messiah, the Savior who was coming into the world. See, maybe Jesus' baptism is less about doing something in order to attain some favor or benefit for himself, and more about participating in that story, the story of salvation. It's less about getting a goodie for himself and more about being obedient to the part that he has to play in the drama of the redemption of the world. Fulfilling all righteousness involves telling that story, enacting that story in a powerful and unforgettable way, so that those who witnessed it would see that in this baptism, in the life of this man who had come from Nazareth to be baptized, God was doing something significant. See, among the gospel writers, Matthew places a particular emphasis on the ways that Jesus' life and Jesus' work fulfill the prophecies of the Old Testament. Earlier we read from Isaiah 42, one of Isaiah's passages about the servant that God was lifting up. And this passage, like a lot of passages in Isaiah, is seen as a foretelling of the shape of Jesus' ministry, the message that Jesus will proclaim, the miracles and acts of mercy that he will perform, the hope that Jesus will bring to those who are living in the darkness of their imprisonment. And while Isaiah is describing that servant, he uses images of humility and gentleness. But at the same time, he invokes language of covenant, vocation, being called, being set apart. He says that this servant will be set apart by God. God's Spirit will be upon him so that he might bring justice and mercy and truth to the hungry and hurting children of God. It's not hard to see these elements at work in the story of Jesus' baptism. This story that Matthew records for us in chapter 3. Jesus' unwavering resolve as he comes to the Jordan, his humble submission, as well as the divine proclamation of approval, when God says, "This is my Son, whom I love." All of these things are seen as fulfillments of Isaiah's prophecy. All of these things signify that the ministry Jesus is about to embark on is the ministry that was foretold by the prophets. So this baptism in Jesus' life is a moment of setting apart. It's a moment of setting him apart for the crucial work that God will do through him. It's setting him apart so that people can see the amazing things that God is accomplishing in this man who is no ordinary man. A few years later, in the early days of the church's mission, when the apostles would proclaim the gospel, they would often tell the story of Jesus' life and ministry. And in at least one instance, in Acts chapter 10, when Peter preaches to the family of Cornelius, the Gentile centurion, Peter brings up the baptism of John. He talks about John's baptism as a kind of starting point of Jesus' life and ministry. Peter talks about Jesus being anointed by the Holy Spirit, doing amazing things in Galilee and beyond. And he goes on to say that this anointing of the Holy Spirit is eventually the anointing that leads Jesus to the cross. And so far from being an isolated event, far from being a moment in which Jesus just gained something for himself and then moved on, and even far from being just an object lesson for us, that moment of Jesus' baptism, that moment beside the Jordan, is a crucial part of the story of who Jesus was. It's a crucial part of the story of what God had promised to accomplish through this servant. When Jesus stood there with John by the Jordan, what he did there wove together the words of the prophets, the work of John, and the ministry of Christ. It served as this kind of catalyzing moment in which righteousness was fulfilled. This moment in which God's purposes were revealed. And it pointed forward to Jesus' death and burial and resurrection. And it did all of these things in a way that still happens for us. A way that we still remember. A way that we still embrace when we undergo baptism. See, no matter how many times we perform it or how many times we witness it, baptism, at its heart, it's a mystery. And this is just as true for our own baptisms as it was for the baptism of Christ. And so as long as we engage in baptism, as long as we reflect on this practice, we'll be compelled to ask what it's doing in our lives. It's human nature to ask these sorts of questions. But one thing we must never do is to see our baptism as just kind of an isolated event. A moment where we get something for ourselves, but a moment that's divorced from the story of our lives. A moment that's divorced from the bigger story of God's salvation among God's people. See, when we submit to the waters of baptism, we're participating in something that's much bigger than ourselves. We're standing on the threshold of the death of the old self and the rebirth of a new one. We're even standing on the threshold of what Paul will call a new creation. We're becoming part of a community. We're being initiated into a work that extends well beyond that moment. In the act of baptism, as Rob shared earlier, that moment when we're cleansed, that moment when the Holy Spirit enters into our lives, God fulfills his righteousness in us. And he does this not just because of the goodies or the benefits that we attain, but also in the way that baptism brings us into a bigger story. Baptism is a moment of setting apart. Baptism is a moment of transformation. Baptism, maybe more than any moment in our lives, is a moment in which God's purposes are revealed in us, and in which God prepares us for all that will follow. Please pray. God, we thank you for the story of Jesus' baptism. We thank you for the ways, Lord, that it resonates with our own baptisms. Lord, it's a moment in which Jesus was set apart. A moment in which you declared that he was your son in a public and powerful way. It's a moment in which he stepped into the ministry, the work that you had prepared for him in a new way. And God, we thank you for our baptisms as well. We thank you for the way that baptism brings us from the old into the new. The way that baptism grants us a new life. The way it cleanses us of our sins of the past and prepares us for a life in your kingdom. God, when we look at the simple act of being immersed in water, it's hard for us to wrap our minds around how such a simple act can accomplish so much. But that's the power of the Spirit. That's the power of your love. It's your power. And so, God, we pray that as we embrace our baptism, as we remember our baptism, as we live out our baptism, that you would reveal that new life in us. Lord, that you would help us to see in that moment that we are your children. We are becoming part of something so much bigger than ourselves. And we are stepping into a life in which you will use us for your kingdom and for your glory. So in your son's name we pray these things. Amen.